We are going to discuss estimation of risk of malignancy in ovarian masses. Now, there are two ways to do it. One is RMI scoring. RMI means risk of malignancy index. And the other is IOTA, IOTA ultrasound rules. IOTA ultrasound rules. IOTA is International Ovarian Tumor Analysis. It is a group of people who made these rules. International Ovarian Tumor Analysis Group. Now what happens here? Let's first have a brief about RMI. There are several RMI scores. Several of them were made, but only two have been validated. These two scores are RMI 1 and RMI 2. RMI 1 is the most widely and most validated one, which is now used nowadays. RMI 1 is found to be more effective than RMI 2. So let's discuss about RMI 1. Risk of malignancy scoring RMI 1. There is a simple formula to remember RMI 1. This is risk of malignancy index is equal to U into M into CA125. CA125 is an important marker which is used in ovarian masses. Generally in suspected ovarian masses, CA125 is found to be raised. But it is also raised in several benign conditions. So it is not a sure, if the CA125 is raised, it is not a sure shot thing that one has malignancy. One has to rule out other causes of raised CA125. So we'll discuss in detail in some other lecture about CA125. Here for our purpose, we should know that CA125, whatever number we get, we get CA125 measured, and we get it measured in the unit of international unit per ml. Whatever number we get, we simply multiply it with these two factors. Now what is U here? U is ultrasound result. U is ultrasound result. So if someone has no ultrasound features, then we give a score of 0. If someone has one ultrasound feature, then we give it a score of 1. And if someone has 2 to 5 ultrasound features, then we give it a score of 3. Now, what are the ultrasound features which we need to know? So, I have made a small formula for easy to remember. M Basu. M for malignancy. If you get a malignancy on an ultrasound picture. B for bilaterality. Bilaterality means both the ovaries are affected. This is an indicator of it could be malignant. A for ascites. S for solid areas. So on an ultrasound, if you are able to appreciate solid areas, there is no cystic area but solid areas, then it is a sign of malignancy. And U for locularity. So if it is multilocular, then again it could be an indication of malignancy. So U for locularity, S for solid areas, A for ascites, B for bilaterality, and M for malignancy. So if you do not find any of it, then the score will be 0. If you found any one of it, then the score is 1. And if you found any feature between 2 to 5, any 2 or 5, all the 5 features, then the score will be 3. This is about U. Now let's talk about our next factor, M. M stands for menopausal status. First, you have to understand what is menopause. So one definition we all know, that menopause is a retrospective diagnosis. Means if somebody is amenorrheic for 12 months, then we call it to be a menopause. Or there is another definition of menopause which is easily forgotten. Woman over 50 years who have had a hysterectomy. Somebody, for example, some woman at the age of 40 years had an hysterectomy done. Now, if she is above 50 years, then she will be regarded as menopausal. So there is something called as surgical menopause. So when it is a misleading term, women who underwent hysterectomy, we often label them to have undergone something called as surgical menopause. Important thing is that suppose a woman got hysterectomy done at the age of 40 years, you can say that she has undergone surgical menopause. But for RMI scoring, she need to be above 40 years in order to be considered as menopause. Why it is important? Because here in the scoring system, in menopause, we give two types of scores, 1 and 3. 1 is the score given to women who are premenopausal, and 3 is given to those who are postmenopausal. Why this difference? Because postmenopausal women are more prone to have malignant ovarian masses as compared to premenopausal women. So those who are postmenopausal have higher score as compared to those who are premenopausal. So if a woman at 40 years of age underwent hysterectomy, she will be considered as premenopausal, although she has attained a surgical menopause. And she will be, and now a woman who is now suppose 55 years of age, who had a hysterectomy done at the age of 40 years, at the age of 40 years hysterectomy was done, she will be put under the category of postmenopause. So she will attain a score of 3 here, but a woman at 40 years of age who had an hysterectomy will still be considered as premenopausal. So this is about our factor M. So this is about RMI score, U into M into CA125. Whatever CA125 you will measure, whatever value you will get with a unit, international unit per ml, you will take the same number here to multiply it with U and M. U we talked about our ultrasound results. Ultrasound we get 3 types of score, 0, 1 and 3. What ultrasound features you have to look for? There's a small mnemonic, M Basu. If none of the features are present, the score will be 0. If only one, any one of the features is present, then score will be 1. If any 2 to 5 of the features are present, then the score will be 3. For M, it is menopausal status. Definition of menopause is very important here in order to allocate the score according to premenopausal, which is 1, and postmenopausal, which is 3. Who are considered menopausal here? Those who have a menopause, that is amenorrhea for 12 months. It is a retrospective diagnosis, the usual definition of menopause. And another important thing which we need to remember, which is not discussed too much, is women who are over 50 years and who have had a hysterectomy. Although at the age of, for example, at the age of 40 years, she had a hysterectomy done. I mean, she has attained surgical menopause at the age of 40 years, but she will still be considered as premenopausal as per RMI scoring. One has to be above 50 years if she had had history of hysterectomy. So this is about RMI score. Now let's talk about the second very important topic, IOTA rules. What are IOTA rules? IOTA stands for International Ovarian Tumor Analysis Group. They give 2 types of rule, B rules and M rules. We will remember the rules in the form of a table and we will differentiate between the 2 rules. Let's first talk of blood supply. In B rule, so you are doing an ultrasound and you will look at the blood supply. If there is no blood supply, it will come under here. B means benign. M means malignant. So if there is no blood supply, then it will come under B rule, and if there is increased blood supply, then this is suspicious of malignancy, so it will come under M rule. Next important thing is, look at the solid area. If solid area is less than 7 mm, it is benign, and if there are irregular solid areas or tumors, then it will come under hen rule. Important is irregular, and here these are regular areas, smooth lining but less than 7 mm. Now next, look at the locularity. Now for locularity, either if it is unilocular or smooth multilocular, less than 10 mm. If it is unilocular or it is multilocular but smooth and less than 10 mm, it will come under B rule. But if it is irregular, multilocular, less than 10 mm, it will come under M rule. So if you are looking at the locularity, if you found it to be unilocular, it is B rule. If you found it to be multilocular but it is smooth and less than 10 mm, again it is B rule. If you found it multilocular and it is irregular and more than 10 mm, it is N rule. Next important thing you have to look for is acoustic shadowing. Acoustic shadowing is when there is a calcified inner tumor, when there is a calcified area. On an ultrasound, there is a shadow behind this acoustic area. So there is a calcified structure. And when we look at this calcified structure, we get a shadowing behind the acoustic structure. The appearance will be like this. This is called as acoustic shadowing. So this is a sign of benign tumor. So this will be acoustic shadowing will come under B rule. What about M rule? There are two important features. At least 4 papillary structures. And another important thing is ascites. At least 4 papillary structures means there is a tumor, and when you see on an ultrasound, you find papillary structures on the surface. This is a sign of malignancy. Or on an ultrasound or on clinical examination in the abdomen, you are getting ascites. Shifting dullness, etc. Or an ultrasound, you find ascites. Then again, it is a sign of malignancy. So, in order to remember it, there's a small mnemonic. Slab. S for solid areas. What about solid areas? If it is less than 7 mm, then it is B rule. If it is irregular solid area or tumor, then it is M rule. Next is locularity. You will look at the locularity. Either you are going to find unilocular tumor or you are going to find multilocular tumor. If it is unilocular, it is benign. If it is multilocular, then you look at the size. If it is a smooth, size and smoothness. If it is a smooth less than 10 mm, it is B rule. If it is irregular and more than 10 mm, then it is M rule. A for multiple things. Ascites, just now we talked, it is M rule. Then at least 4 papillary structures. It is again M rule. And another is acoustic shadowing. It is B rule. And B for blood flow. If blood flow is not increased, it is B rule. If it is increased, it is M rule. This is about iota, M rules and B rules. Now, next very important question you can ask is, which among them is better? Which is better? RMI 1 or iota rules? So studies were conducted and they found that sensitivity and specificity of RMI is 78% sensitivity and 87% specificity. So it's pretty good. But for iota rules, they found that sensitivity is 95% and specificity is 91%. So this is, iota is much better than RMI. So nowadays, if you have been given an option, then iota is better than RMI score. This is for today. Thanks.